One of the reasons we wanted to have this panel is obviously the cannabis industry, as it's now called, has been a huge underground business. Now it's an above ground business. And it's a business that is really new, and it's a business that has an opportunity to shape itself as a business. And some of the people that we're going to hear from today are in the process of shaping this business to hopefully create a more inclusive industry for the many people who've been part of it for many years. There are a lot of new people coming into this business, and there are people who've been in this business for a long time and have taken a lot of personal risks to be in this business. And we want to honor those people as well, because that's important. If we don't know our history, we don't know our future. Okay. So since we're gonna do this alphabetically, I get the privilege of introducing Danielle Barber again. Except I have some new information to add that wasn't added last time. So Danielle is a cannabis wellness consultant, and she's been with the Harborside Health Center since 2007. 10 years. Right. Thank you. I also want to thank the people at Harborside. My friend Steve D'Angelo and his crew at Harborside have been sponsors of this event. Thank you. I've known Steve for, 15, almost 20 years. I used to be a business reporter covering the cannabis business. Boy, was that a great beat. Steve was one of my sources, and he's a righteous guy. Thank you, Steve. And thank you, Harborside crew. And if you're a patient and you want to go to an excellent cannabis dispensary, check them out. I will. I've been there. So Danielle's been with Harborside since 2007. Danielle Barber, during that time, she's worked in several leadership roles. She's currently serving as the Ombuds Manager and Local Community Engagement Representative. Danielle grew up in Oakland as the daughter of a Baptist minister. Yeah. Now, this upbringing has allowed for a unique perspective on life and a tremendous amount of empathy and compassion towards others. I imagine so. Being one of the few people of color in a leadership role in the industry, Danielle has more recently become involved in vocalizing the need to create a more diverse leadership and ownership dynamic in the industry. And as she said earlier, she is the co-chair of OAKDEC, Oakland Diversity and Equity Cannabis Coalition. And has organized several events focused on building diversity in the industry, and we're delighted to have her here.
Kind of touching more into the diversity piece, you know? And even when we look amongst this room, you know, it's pretty diverse. But when you think about Oakland as a whole, and even the cannabis industry as a whole, this isn't necessarily completely representative of what the cannabis industry looks like. And I'm not necessarily talking about professionally, but just, you know, the folks who are getting arrested, the folks who have been affected by the war on drugs and all that. And so, you know, with organizations like this, with the Women's Visionary Congress, OAKDEC, Supernova, Hood Incubator, all those organizations are really put into place so that we can really reach out to those communities who aren't completely involved in the cannabis industry, who don't have cannabis organizations as their friends on Facebook and who see that, you know? And so it's really a matter of us reaching out to all of the people that we know in those communities and really educating them and making sure that they're aware of the industry and why they need to be involved. The OAKDEC are, we like to focus on three things. So awareness, access, And now I can't think of the last one. But ultimately, we just want to make sure that they're aware of it. They want to make sure that they have access to the resources. And just making sure that we also include that advocacy piece, right? Because we're nothing. If we're in a room of people who already know what's going on, then that doesn't really make a difference. You know, we have to make sure that we're getting out there into the communities and letting people know about these things. And so one of the events that I recently did was Opportunities in Legal Cannabis. And it was at Yoshi's, and it ultimately really was catered to a lot of the Chambers of Commerce members, mainly those of color. But also we wanted to reach out to pastors, to just regular people in the communities. You know, people who, like I said, aren't necessarily involved in the cannabis industry. Maybe they've heard a little chatter about it, but they've tried to kind of keep their hands off because they're a little hesitant about getting into the industry because they've been the ones who have been affected, because they're the ones who often get arrested. Even though we know, I mean, when you look at this room, I don't know if everybody who uses cannabis, I'm just gonna assume that y'all do. whatever. But we know that if everybody in this room uses cannabis, right? And mainly this room is filled with non-people of color, right? So if mainly people of color are the ones who are getting arrested, but we know that everybody's kind of using cannabis, that doesn't make any sense. So we want to make sure that those people know, listen, there's rules set in place right now that are going to protect you, that encourage you to come into this community. And we all, I think, all agree on the same thing, that we want more diverse in the community. In any organization, diversity is going to make that organization better. Studies have shown that. So if we have more diversity in this community, in this industry, we know it's going to get better. We know that we're going to be able to stop those big hands from the mom and pop shops and cutting them off. But we have to stand as a community. And we can't do it with just these people in this room. We have to do it with all those people who have been affected by the war on drugs. We got to make sure that we get all those pastors, those churches who don't know. That's, you know, something else that I've been working on. My dad is a pastor. I grew up in a Baptist church. Thankfully, my father was always very open-minded about cannabis, and he never shunned me. In fact, I used cannabis in my home, you know, when I was living with them, and it was always more encouraged. I'd rather you be here where I know you're in a controlled environment. I know what you're using. I know who you're with. And I really appreciated that because I know that was a very unique thing for me and any pastor, pastor's daughter. And so I didn't grow up having to do sneaky stuff behind their back. They knew everything, all the sneaky stuff I did. And I always felt with cannabis, I felt, hey, my mama know I use it, I don't care about nobody else. So, I mean, you know, but just being able to be open with my parents allowed me to feel comfortable with also communicating that to the pastors of the churches. And so we do need to feel comfortable with communicating to those people who are completely outside of this industry, because right now it's going to affect everybody. Like Danielle talked, it's at this point, it's going to affect everybody, whether you use it or not, you know? And so especially people of color need to get involved, need to be educated, but we all need to be involved. We all need to be educated because there's so much about this industry that people are still learning. We're all still, all the people that are in this industry, Debbie's been involved in this industry for 10,000 million trillion years. And I would imagine, she's still learning new things every day. There's so much, it's hard to keep up. But if collectively as a whole, that we make sure that we stay together and not divided. Because even in this industry, there's a lot of division. And we have to really get it. We don't have the room to be divided. You know, we don't have that capacity. We need to stay united. And that's making sure that we're communicating with each other. We're advocating outside of our communities, or rather our own personal communities. And we're talking to those people, or we're talking to our family, we're talking to our friends, and we're letting them know about cannabis and what it can actually do. We're talking to our doctors, because they don't know, all the doctors don't know. If they're not actively researching cannabis, then they're not gonna know either. I have plenty of doctors that I've educated about cannabis. So I would imagine most of y'all in here probably know more about cannabis than your doctors do. So keep that in mind. We have to be open and willing to talk about that, because when we don't, that's how we keep keeping it you know, where the, like I said, that farm, the big farmer's gonna get a hold of it if we don't essentially make sure that we stay in control. Right now we're in control. So we need to keep that. Make sure you educate those people. Talk to your people. So I think that's it.
Hey, Danielle, would you mind like coming up here and joining our panel? I'm gonna ask the three other panelists also to come up and join us too. Amber Center, Debby Goldsberry, who's over here, and Julie Vasconi as well. If you could join us here in our panel. And the next person that we're gonna ask to speak is Debby Goldsberry, who I've known for a long time. She's a founding mother of the cannabis industry. And I'm gonna have Dennis Berry introduce Debby, if you would do that. Because we like to share the MC duties, and I'm delighted to have you here, Debby. Thank you.
So I think when people have bios, that's always important things that we want to know about them. She's been active in the cannabis community for more than 25 years, co-founding the Berkeley Patients Group in 2000. She went on to direct the organization for 11 years as it became one of the most successful dispensaries in Northern California. Yeah. Goldsberry parted ways with BPG and went on to co-found Communicare Centers, a collective dedicated to standardized cannabis medicines. In addition to her work with dispensaries, she has a long history of involvement with cannabis policy movements, co-founding Americans for Safe Access, the Medical Cannabis Safety Council, and the Cannabis Action Network, which influenced the creation of Students for Sensible Drug Policy and the Marijuana Policy Project. She also supports the causes of others as well as her own. She volunteers with Normal Women's Alliance and formerly served as a Marijuana Policy Project board member. She's received numerous awards for her work for the cannabis community, twice been named the High Times Freedom Fighter of the Month, and received Freedom Fighter of the Year for 2011 through 2012. Normal awarded Goldsberry with the Paula Sabine Award for Women in Leadership in 2005. Thank you so much.
Amber, is this okay? I'm lying there, right over you. What to do with my notes? Is it? Can I take the mic and just put it here?
Absolutely.
Okay, this is a little bit better for me. Okay, hey, it's my 50th birthday in a couple of weeks, March 15th. Menopause for a minute. No. Sorry. It's on the top of my mind. All right. Let's see what to say. It's really great to be here, first of all. This is amazing. Thank you so much. And it's incredible that people are creating spaces for women to get together to talk about our issues. Of course, we're inviting every single person to come and help discuss our issues because we are one planet, one people, and the more we're together, working together, the better off we are. So this is really quite enjoyable to be here this morning. Thank you, Annie and Carolyn and Maria, for making such a lovely group for us. I got my start in the marijuana industry. When I first time I used marijuana, I thought my life changed for the better that day. I was like, it was one way the day before, now it's this way. That's incredible. I couldn't even believe that one time using marijuana could make my life so much better. I mean, I suspect medically maybe I was cannabinoid deficient. And once I had enough cannabinoids on board, I felt myself for the first time, a wonderful feeling. I never wanted to stop. At our college campus, U of I, they used to have this big smoke-in. It was kind of a leftover from the hippies doing the smoke-ins at the college campuses around the Midwest. It was called Hash Wednesday. Every third Wednesday in April, we would come out to the campus and we'd smoke pot right in the middle of campus. And when I was a sophomore, it was so fun because somebody brought a 30-foot bong and a lifeguard chair, and he had to sit in the lifeguard chair to smoke the bong. 1988, Reagan had become president, and he threatened all those colleges. If you don't crack down on those smoke-ins, I don't know what, you know what they say, we're gonna take away federal, something bad's gonna happen, federal funding, you, who knows, yeah. So, 88, when we came to the campus that third Wednesday, which by the way was 420, I can't even believe that, but it was 420, the police were there, and they beat us up with billy clubs, and they made us bloody. So to go from one year to the next, to have such a big disconnect to me was just, it was untenable. It couldn't be true, it couldn't be logical. Here we are at the University of Illinois, they're teaching us to think critically, to study politics, and to make decisions that make sense, and this is what they're doing, made no sense. They said, you'll never be back again. Well, you're quite wrong, actually. We're gonna be back next year, and not only that, well, we got an attitude now, we're gonna be on every college campus in the state of Illinois next year, and we were. And when we called for solidarity, we got it. Normal came the next year. Steve DeAngelo came the next year because his girlfriend at the time, Ruby Pearl was born and raised in Champaign-Urbana. And when she heard they were beating the kids bloody in Champaign-Urbana, her and Steve showed up. The guy who founded Normal went to college at U of I, so Normal was there. High Times, the guy who was the editor of High Times at the time, Steve Hager, he's born and raised in Champaign-Urbana. So it was a national rally cry. Are you kidding me? They're attacking Champaign-Urbana. It's one of those things you read about when you're in the right place in the right time and you realize you can get the job done and you take the ball and you run with it and you do it. So we were empowered and we did it. We were so successful, we never wanted to stop. The next fall, we said, well, so successful in 5 states, we're gonna do rallies in all the states that touch Illinois. How do you like that? And we did, in all the college campuses where we could find organizers through Normal, through any way we could, and it was so successful that the next time we did 17 states that next spring. And then that was so successful, we just went everywhere for years on the hemp tour. It was really amazing. I mean, I dropped out of U of I to do this project. But this year, something really amazing happened. I got contacted, it's the 150th anniversary of U of I. I don't know if Danielle's a U of I student also, we were both in the same chapter of Normal there on campus. They contacted me as a VIP alumni and asked me to put in an essay to the newspaper, for the Champaign-Urbana newspaper, about my history and how U of I changed my life. I told my mom right away. Yes, college dropout to VIP. That's how you do it. You know, one reason I like this is because when I was in college, I read Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test. I'm sure many of us read it. And I read about Mountain Girl and Karen Garcia, a real hero to me, because I saw all those men, and I saw her standing up with her voice, being so creative and so energetic, that they listened, and they took her advice, and I saw that women could lead, and that women could have fun, and that by having fun and by being leaders, by being ourselves, we can make movements that change the world. So thank you, Carolyn Garcia, for inspiring so many people. I founded the Berkeley Patients Group with another visionary leader, Jim McClelland. We didn't know Jim was dying of AIDS. He didn't tell us. We founded Berkeley Patients Group over the course of the last year of his life. And we thought, we just didn't know. But Jim was thinking, what do I do with the last year of my life? How am I gonna spend my time? Am I gonna be alone? Am I gonna be worried? Or am I gonna create a community? And what's that community gonna look like? Is it gonna be boring and tedious and worrisome? No, there's gonna be music, and there's gonna be fun, and there's gonna be food, and there's gonna be people. We're gonna gather constantly all the time. We're gonna smoke weed. Nobody can tell us we can't. We're gonna have free coffee. We're gonna have speeches, we're gonna have lectures, we're gonna empower people, we're gonna teach people, we're gonna be an inspiration so other people do the same thing that we do, and that we can build a community that supports us. And it was beautiful, and we did lose Jim a year into the project. So shout out to Jim McClellan, let's hear it for Jim. At Berkeley Patients Group, we knew that we weren't safe if everyone wasn't safe, and we knew that most of us were giving the police enough information to send us to jail, sometimes even for life, in the first couple of minutes that we were talking to them, that we didn't know enough to say, I choose to remain silent and I want to see my lawyer, when the police were questioning us. We didn't know that if we said, I don't consent to this search, when the police were knocking on our door, if they lied on the search warrant, that we would be able to fight that. And if we didn't say, I don't consent, their lies would send us to jail. I knew that if my friends didn't know if they arrested me and them and put us in separate rooms, that they could tell them that I snitched on them and me that they snitched on, they could tell us all we were snitching on each other so truthfully that we believed them, but that was a lie. And if people didn't understand that the police could lie and that they were using tricks that they were taught through their education to send us to jail, that we would go to jail, and that in fact we were going to jail in epic numbers. I knew that if we didn't learn the magic words, I choose to remain silent, I want to see my lawyer, and I do not consent to this search, we'd never win. So at Berkeley Patients Group, we dedicated ourselves to educating people, everyone, patients, our staff members, all of you, anyone we could get our hands on, teaching the magic words. That's why we formed Americans for Safe Access. We couldn't believe that they were taking patients to jail and that we could prevent it just by teaching people the rights given to us in our Constitution, by forming a community of people, including lawyers, that were ready to stand up together and not be so fearful of the federal government, understanding that the voters control this democracy and that our votes matter, and that with feds, when they come after our votes, that's a crime, and that we can only fight back as a community. So we built that community. And you can see after 20 years, this incredible movement that we've created. Let's hear it for the incredible movement that we've created over 20 years. And I always knew it wasn't over. And I was very worried that we were gonna get complacent, that we would forget that we were advocates first, that we were fighting for our constitutional rights, that even if they legalized marijuana, that someday the federal government could just change on a dime and come after us again, and that no matter what, we needed to have our skills all the time. Don't forget your skills. Spread the skills, share the magic words. Right now, I run the Magnolia Wellness Dispensary in Oakland, and we're just getting ready to open a new dispensary in Berkeley at Amoeba Music on Telegraph Avenue. It's gonna be incredible, can't wait. Music and marijuana heals people, makes them feel better. And we're just really honored to bring those two things together and to provide them to people. I can't wait till we're doing pairings, you know. You want an indica? How about some Pink Floyd, you know? You're looking for a sativa? We've got some Sublime music to go with that. We'll see. Amoeba is a women-owned cooperative. All of our senior leadership is women. Our GM is a woman. Our assistant GM is a woman. I'm the executive director. I'm a woman. I really like working in teams of strong women. We have men on the team. They're excellent, too. There's something about me working together with women, the bond that we can form, because we just know each other, and we understand what we've had to fight against to get where we are. And we know that we have to make opportunities and lead, and we're really excited about what we're doing. We're Oakland's most innovative dispensary. We just got our permit for on-site cannabis consumption, first in the East Bay. We're opening a dab bar and a cannabis cafe. We bought a restaurant. We're gonna have cannabis-infused food. We're gonna make fresh edibles. We're gonna make infused coffee and cappuccinos. We're gonna create a place where you can come, sit together, meet, enjoy a coffee, consume some cannabis, and be yourself. We have a farmer's market. We just got permitted to have a marijuana farmer's market in our parking lot. We extended the dispensary boundaries to the parking lot. We're gonna be setting up 15 to 18 farmer's booths in the parking lot on March 18th, and we're gonna have my birthday party that day, so come over to Magnolia on March 18th. Hope you can make it. And we're opening an equity incubator in that space because we believe that we need to make space from our position. We fought to get where we are, but now where we are is a position of privilege. We have to share that privilege and we have to make space for others. So we're creating an equity incubator in our restaurant where Oakland's low-income businesses will be able to come and rent space by the hour, learn from experts like myself, have desk space, get introduced to funders, and have all the same opportunities that I've had in my career. So we're very excited about this. And what else do I want to say? We're obviously at a transitional place in the cannabis movement. Not sure if we're a movement or an industry, or industry movement or movement industry. What are we? I don't know. I think we're a cannabis industry. That's what I call myself, but I'm in the industry, so that makes sense. How do we keep values-based? as we move into an industry? How do we make sure that our cannabis industry businesses are putting their money into the causes that we so care about, ending prohibition, keeping people out of prison, ending the inequalities and the arrests? I saw that that equity analysis they did in Oakland showed that 1,000 people of color have been arrested in Oakland recently. And what is it, 25 white people? Something like that. Do you remember what it was? Some ridiculous low amount. So offensive and outrageous. How are we going to keep values-based? This isn't about money. This is about changing society. This is about making opportunities. It's about creating an industry that's going to be socially responsible and make better communities. How are we going to do that? Well, we're going to prove it with our own businesses again and again by showing that when you're an organization that works for your community, that does good work, that changes laws, that makes regulations and provides opportunity, you make money and everybody wins. We have to prove that concept again and again and again and again. And I'll tell you who's doing it best. Women run businesses. So keep up the good work. Well, there's still a lot of opportunity to get involved in California and in Oakland. The state regulations are not created yet. The local regulations are not written yet. They have not been passed. If you want to get involved, your voice will matter, and your voice and your good ideas can be incorporated in the law. This is a democracy. This is an amazing opportunity for us to create the law that governs us into the future. So I urge you, stay and get political. And I also urge you, don't miss out. This is the next billion-dollar industry. Start a business. Get involved. Do you have a dream? Let's figure out how to dream build. What's your dream? Let's make it come true. You have an idea? I'm ready to help. I wrote a book. It's coming out June 13th. It's an idiot's guide. It's one of those idiot's guide series, DK books, Penguin books. Starting and running a marijuana business. Soon, for $21 plus tax, you'll be able to get all my best ideas, start to finish. You know what? You gotta start with the history. You gotta understand, how did prohibition happen? What on earth happened in our history that allowed prohibition to take effect and stay for 100 years? That's crazy. How did we battle back? What skills did we need? And how do we make sure we don't lose those skills and get complacent, so if there's another administration change 20 years in the future again, we don't know how to handle it. So we have to start there. How do you build a good team? How do you set up your facility? How do you find a location? How do you operate a business? How do you manage accounting? How do you manage human resources? How do you handle marketing? How do you found a company? How do you incorporate your company? How do you fund your company? None of it's easy. But I want to tell you, I'm here for you. A couple of my Magnolia members are here. We hold a class every single Sunday from 10 o'clock till noon. It's on cannabis management. It's totally free. We're walking through the book start to finish. We're starting again on day one in May, so you'll be able to come and learn for free all of these skills. I'm here for you. I'm happy to mentor. I'm happy to coach. I'm happy to give you advice, and I'm happy to be a part of this community. So I'm delighted to be here and share this joy of this wonderful event with you guys, and thank you so much for letting me have this time.
Really appreciate you being here. Carolyn Garcia, could you please come up to the microphone? Carolyn Garcia is the first board president of the Women's Visionary Council. Yeah. She named this organization. She did. And she wrote one of the very first books on growing cannabis called Primo Plant, which is for sale over there in the corner. Ellen Comp's book, Token Women, is also for sale over there in the corner. And Carolyn is going to introduce our next speaker, Amber Center, who is a businesswoman who has just started her own business called Leisure Life. Did I get that right?
And you're Amber.
Yeah, and she's going to talk about the edibles business, which is huge, and we want to hear about that. So I'm going to let you introduce Amber.
Well, I have not met Amber before today, but I see her sitting before me with a big smile, so it must all be okay. So Amber has had 18 years of marketing and project management experience. in her law in long dog consulting. I don't know if that's just consulting about long dogs, but it really sounds good. Now, she was in the U.S. Coast Guard, so you know she's organized. And her pre-cannabis career was providing design and marketing services to big companies, including Home Depot, our favorite Walmart, and wonderful Whole Foods. Now those are serious consulting jobs. And after years of employment, traditionally in the marketplace, she went to California and became an established medical cannabis promoter, it sounds like to me, for her most of her time here in California, and went from being creative director at cannabis consulting firms to chief operations officer, yes, we like that, at Magnolia Wellness. Her voice is trusted in the cannabis industry, and her unsurpassed knowledge of the medical and recreational user base. We really have something here. She's been doing so much to promote this industry, to make it a safe industry, to make it a diverse industry. Each of the people that you see here today has been active in inclusiveness, active in teaching what the vast, incredible possibilities of cannabis industry is for women. And as part of the Compassionate Care Collective, which I don't know very much about, but I like everything I've heard about, and I'm not a medical patient, and I've been involved with all this stuff for 50 years too. And so the whole medical creation has been sort of a marvel to me. And there's still people out there that are too scared to come in. And we really have to pay attention to the folks that say, oh, I don't want to be on the list. You know, and I hear that a lot from my old white friends in Oregon. You know, they're still terrified they're going to be chased down by some phantom agency. So, you know, please, people, we need to bring our friends in, get them the care they need, and give credit to where it's due. And now, the edibles part, which is something we love very, very much. And I hope that you do talk about that for us.
So, good afternoon. I think it's afternoon. So, I'll just talk a little bit about my story and where I'm at in this whole edibles thing. So I moved to California 3 years ago. I was diagnosed with lupus, Lyme disease, mixed connective tissue disease, Sjogren's syndrome, a bunch of autoimmunes, and I was really sick. I was living in Chicago at the time. I was helping my mom take care of my grandma because my grandma was just diagnosed with breast cancer. So I moved to Chicago from Atlanta. I was there for about a year, and I hadn't been in Chicago in a really long time. That's where I grew up, but I hadn't been there for several years, and that was my first time being there, enduring a winter in Chicago in probably a good 10 years. And things had changed in my body that I wasn't very aware of, and I got really sick and ended up being diagnosed with all those things. So I said, oh my gosh, I gotta get out of Chicago. This place is gonna kill me. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about moving back to Atlanta until Mr. Mickey Martin contacted me and said, you know, if you go back to Atlanta, you're gonna go to jail because you love weed too much. And he was right. I love cannabis. I'm a professional weed smoker. So he said, how about you come out here to California and just check it out and see what you think? And I said, okay. So we could really use your marketing expertise in the cannabis industry. So, okay. So I came out here to check it out. I didn't have a place to stay, I didn't have that much money. So he said, oh, I'm gonna reach out to my friend and see if you can stay with my friend, Debby Goldsberry. So Debbie said, sure, yes. And so I stayed with Debbie. And I first flew out here, I landed, Mickey Kim picked me up from the airport and he took me to Debbie's radio show. And Ed Rosenthal, Mickey Martin, and Debbie were on the radio show that day. And I did my first dab on Debbie's radio show. And I coughed for about a half an hour. But I really liked Oakland. Mickey took me on a tour of Oakland. We went to Amsterdam. I'd read all these things about it. I was very aware of what happened here and what the cannabis scene was like and the people that were involved. But it was all just a dream to me. You know, I was living on the East Coast and just doing a lot of studying and wondering how I would ever make it to California. So I spent a few days here. And I really liked it. So Mickey says, you're gonna take me up on my offer? And I said, yes. So I moved here about 2 months later and Debbie let me stay with her because I didn't have a place. And while I was looking for a place, I stayed with Debbie for about 6 weeks. And that's how Debbie and I became friends. And Debbie's, the first day I moved to California was Debbie's first day working at Magnolia. So it's kind of funny how that all worked out. So I ended up finding my footing and working through the industry. And then when Debbie took over Magnolia, November of 2015, she asked me if I would come along and help her. So I did, and worked there for about a year. And while I was there, I co-founded Supernova right around that time when I was coming on to Magnolia. And Supernova was formed because we noticed that there were a lot of owners in the cannabis industry, but not many people of color that owned businesses. And you know, we see obviously the disproportionate effects that the war on drugs has had on people of color and in our communities. And it was really disturbing. And we didn't know what to do, so we just gotta do something. We just gotta start teaching people stuff. We just have to start talking to people about what's going on and making them aware that this industry is about to be regulated, and if you don't get in, you won't have a chance. And so we just started doing stuff. So we put on a panel discussion, and we did it here at Oakstop back in January of 2016. And it was a success, you know, the place was packed. It was standing room only, it was crazy. So we said, oh wow, okay, we've got to do this again. So we did it in San Francisco, and it was the same thing. So, okay, well, I wonder if we can do this in another state. So we did it in Massachusetts and in Boston, and it was the same thing. So then we did another one in LA, it's the same thing. So it's like, oh wow, this is really needed. We're definitely doing a service to our community by just educating them and telling them from our experiences what it's like being in the cannabis industry and really how to get involved and just utilizing our contacts to help each other. And it's been awesome, you know? So then we put on a workshop here at Oakstop, again, on the licensing process and kind of what that's gonna be like for Oakland. And, you know, we've been doing a lot of teaching people on how to start their own businesses and how to run their own businesses. And so I decided that it was my time to do the same thing. And so I left Magnolia about 2 months ago, and I started my own edibles kind of lifestyle brand. It's an indica dominant lifestyle brand. It's called Leisure Life to promote a chill lifestyle, which is, I think, what we all strive for. And it's been going really well. Products available at Magnolia. And more places coming soon. We've also rolled out a pre-roll as well. It's called a California roll. It's a pre-roll with top shelf flowers, rolled in CO2 oil, and then rolled in keef. Triple threat. That's gonna be available at Magnolia on Monday. It's brand new product. It's exciting.
What's it called?
California Roll. California Rolls. So, yeah, you know, this journey has been amazing. It's been really awesome teaching people and learning along the way. Everything that I learned, I've just been trying to turn around and teach as many people as possible. I feel like I've been in hypergrowth. This has just been in the last 3 years since I've moved to California. And I just want to bring as many people along with me as I can, because, you know, we can do this. It's not easy, but it's worth it. So thank you.
We're gonna have one more panelist, Julia Vasconi, and MG, do you want to introduce Julia too?
I'm sorry, you're gonna have to work on that.
Okay, all right, no worries.
You can if you want me to.
It's
that
totally up to you.
Warning.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yes, ma'am. I can do it. That's okay. I asked Julia to come and speak because I wanted someone to speak for the trimmers. The trimmers are an essential part of the cannabis economy. They are the, I think, unsung heroes of the cannabis economy. Many, many people around the world have come to California and other places to be trimmers. And yet they are often invisible. They are often not given the due credit for the risks they take sitting up on farms, sometimes remote farms, sometimes for many weeks and months, doing their work. And we consume the end product, and yet we are sometimes not aware of the entire communities of people who come and do this work for us, people who consume the product, who consume the plant. So I want to just say a couple of things about Julia. Julia lives between the Bay Area and Olympia, Washington. She is a final year student at Evergreen State College with an education focusing on biology, psychology, and dance kinesiology. Julia started her relationship with cannabis in her early teen years when she lived in Anchorage, Alaska. As she grew older, the relationship shifted from being a consumer to connecting more intimately with the plant through working in the trim scene in Northern California at age 19, right? A lot of students work in the trim scene. For the past 3 years, she has supplemented her income with this kind of work as she finished her bachelor's degree at Evergreen. Ever since the first time she attended the Women's Visionary Congress in 2014, Julia has been interested in immersing herself in the topics of sensible drug policy and fighting the war on drugs. Julia seeks to empower young women in the underground cannabis industries through sharing of her own experiences and relaying safety tactics for high liability trimming jobs. Yeah, I wanted her to come and talk about what it's like to be a young woman in the trim business sitting up on a remote farm someplace. Mm-hmm. We've had a lot of those conversations. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. In her spare time, Julia enjoys cooking with butter, marijuana infused or not, doing yoga, updating her music library, and always figuring out new ways to sustain her life unconventionally. Please welcome Julia Vasconi.
Good afternoon. I just want to start out by saying thank you to Annie, who has supported me really on this journey. It's funny, the first WVC I ever went to, I had a chance encounter with a person that was speaking at that event who offered me my first job trimming on his marijuana farm. And this was kind of a controversial thing at the time. I called Annie, who I'd never spoken to before, and said, I got offered this position and I don't know how you feel about it, but I would actually like some like positive reinforcement and backup because I've never done this kind of thing before. And she was like, wow, I can't believe that happened at my conference. She's like, oh yeah, I totally have your back. We're like watching this guy. So I just really, really want to say thank you for that. And here I am now speaking at one of her, it's something that she helps put on. Hi, my name is Julia Vasconi. I'm a senior at Evergreen State College in Olympia, Washington, one of the top weed smoking colleges in the US. I assume that many of you smoke pot, but how many of you always know who grows and processes your pot? A few of you, okay. I'm here as a representative of thousands of women who have participated as a so-called trimmigrant in the Northern California cannabis growing culture. A trimmigrant is a person, guy or gal, who finds themselves on a pot farm clipping away excess leaves on the buds that you end up smoking in whichever way you fancy. Up until recently, one can make a decent living sitting in a room with a few others for possibly 12 hours a day to trim pot for under the table cash. I started trimming in 2014 during my freshman year in college. At the time, just 3 years ago, trimming a pound of weed equaled $200 in my pocket. As a college kid with a streak for adventure and an affinity for pot, the idea was appealing. If you were to ask me if I've trimmed pot you may have bought from a dispensary, the answer would be, I have no idea. The thing about this underground industry is it revolves heavily around the relationship of those who grow the weed and we who process it. The relationship between the growers of the plant and those who are hired in carloads to trim it is as much of a gray area as the growing industry has been. Everything basically that you hear on a pot farm is word of mouth, with some bullshit slipped in to keep untrustworthy ears at bay. You get accused of being a cop a lot. There's a lot of mistrust with newcomers on a piece of property. The reason for this is that most farms are doing something illegal, either for protection from outsiders stealing plants, which is a thing, and tampering with them in general. Sometimes people will come and just chop down plants to like lessen the competition. Or to maximize their own grow profit. Law enforcement is the arch enemy of any grower. Aside from the alliances inevitably that trimmers make, the fear of law enforcement or violation of the growers, there is an ever-present feeling of paranoia working in these environments. Each farm has its own personal issues and collectively surmount to the culture of growing pot at large. The freedom in living in a Wild West-like storyline comes at the price, at times, of worker exploitation in ways quite unlike the regular kinds in the mainstream workforce. And again, massive paranoia. Trimmers are largely a female population. The reasons for this is, for one, they tend to be faster with smaller, nimbler fingers. And second, the population of growers is largely men who appreciate the company of young women. The power dynamics within this relationship is no different than in mainstream culture, with the men on these farms holding most of the cards and determining much of the pay and making final decisions for the property dwellers. As a trimmer and activist, my simplest wish is to raise awareness around these power dynamics, to reduce harm and inequity in pot farm environments and communities. No matter what happens as a result of Prop 64 and cannabis growing culture at large, not to mention to inform consumers about the firsthand count of the range of ways that pot can be for better for can be grown and processed for better or for worse, I've actually trimmed weed that has like made me break out in hives because of some pesticides that they use and don't tell us what. So like sometimes we'll like be covering ourselves head to toe in protection so that we don't get affected by this like just hay basically that we're trimming. I haven't trimmed like really seriously for, I skipped last year, I did the year before, and I kind of came to the conclusion that I can't really do it anymore. They're not offering enough money to justify it. I actually had a skiing injury this spring before I was trimming 2 years ago, and never got physical therapy for it, and I was sitting in a dark room for weeks with a few of my friends, and I just had this terrible like shoulder pain start happening. And then my knee like swelled up and my like foot was stuck at like a 45 degree angle from like not moving enough. And so I had to rush to San Francisco to get it checked out by a doctor and like missed out on a few weeks of trimming for my health. But it's not a low impact job. There's a lot of traveling that goes along with it. Being uprooted from like you're living a nomadic lifestyle and like needing to be prepared for the worst when you're on these farms with people that you've probably never met before. You're as wary of them as they are of you. And it's hard. It's hard and it's stressful. But it's also not all bad. I've met a lot of amazing people doing this. And some of those people are parents. Some of those people are people in their middle age that suffered losses from the economic crash of 2008. Some people are artists that produce work for large festivals like Burning Man that attract thousands and thousands of people every year. It's an amazingly, I mean, it's pretty diverse. There's people that fly into a place called Garberville, California, Northern California. yeah, Garberville. What do they say? Garbageville. They call it Garbageville. From all over the world, there's people that fly in to get their piece of the pie in the Green Rush in Northern California. And like somebody was saying earlier, I don't remember exactly who, cannabis has this amazing way of bringing people together. I was just hearing a story about the other day about a piece of pot farm property out in Grass Valley that is being passed on to a totally different type of group of people. There's like, I mean, some of that country out there is Trump country, which is different than the community that many of us are a part of. And the property that was nourishing these plants ended up bridging a gap between people of our community and people from more rural towns, just in the interest and in the honoring of cannabis. And I think that's amazing, and I want to continue to see that flourish and grow. So thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Julia, for being here. Thank you to all the trimmers, anybody out there who has ever trimmed, to all the people who are trimming right now, sitting in some little room, sitting in some little shed, sitting in some little tent somewhere out on some piece of land, trimming the bud that you smoke. They deserve respect, and they deserve our acknowledgement, and they deserve our support. They are the farm workers of our industry. And like most farm workers, they don't get enough support and credit and respect. So, thank you, trimmers. So we're gonna take a few questions for our panelists, and then our panelists have graciously agreed to do breakout sessions during lunch. And you can go to lunch during our hour lunch hour with some of these amazing women. Stay here, bring your lunch in, hang out. We're going to serve tea, and then we'll start again in an hour. So we have a couple minutes for questions. Back in the back row, Hidden Mountain.
Julia, yeah. You know we collect safety tips.
Yeah.
Have you got a couple to contribute?
All right, I'm going to pass
to
the mic.
Yes.
We love safety tips.
Thank you for asking. I think, so, when you get a group of women together, they can be unstoppable. So really, like, strength in numbers and having your people, like your trim sisters, thank you, nearby and being available to support others. I think, yeah, building community is the biggest way to prevent exploitation on a pot farm. Always giving yourself an exit strategy. Not going anywhere if you don't have a car, like readily available for you to use. What else? There's this big thing about being afraid of not being paid at the end of a season, and I've had to learn how to negotiate and advocate for myself in those situations where it seemed like a gray area, like whether or not I'd be paid in cash or in pot that I was expected to distribute. And I've driven up the highway with a pound of weed in my car and been like, why am I doing this? So being really clear about what you expect, having backup, like having Annie in our community as backup that first time was like, wow, I have something to fall back on. Like, I'm not just going to this random person's property and like doing work for them all summer and learning how to grow. Like, that's really sweet and innocent in nature, but people like to exploit people. I mean, even on accident, it just happens.
Can you talk about sexual exploitation as well? Because we're hearing reports about that.
Sure, yeah. That's a big thing. I've been really lucky to be on people's like personal boutique style farms that only have, you know, 90 to 200 plants, and be welcomed into people's families and homes, and that's really amazing. But not everyone's that lucky. A lot of people go to these small rural pot farms, and they get work just by posting something on Craigslist, and like sometimes those posts on Craigslist are of like trim women that are. That post like suggestive pictures of themselves to gain the attention of growers, and to there's desperation of work and they want to be paid, and it's really sad to me that is part of that culture, because something as pure as the plant can produce this kind of behavior. Yeah, I don't personally know anybody that has been really exploited other than not being paid. I haven't met anybody that's been sexually exploited.
It's not that rampant as the reports make it sound.
No, but when it does happen, it's horrible. It's horrible. I've heard about some people being locked in sheds for days and like not being let out, or like being forced to trim topless and stuff. It's like, it's pretty gnarly.
I have a question.
I wanted to ask,
do you want, as a trimmer in this industry, do you want to see more regulation and more enforcement in the trimming aspect of the industry? And if so, how do you think that will impact, you know, the industry for the, you know, the small farmer? Because what you're talking about now is, you know, and what's happened in a lot of industries is what we call whistleblowers and things like that. And that's it's kind of a rough position to be put in. And even you coming up here today and actually not in some mask or something like that and expressing this, I just want to give you, you know, some props for that before you even answer. But I'm very thankful for you coming out of the shadows and kind of letting people know that it's just not an all glamorous Hollywood type of situation. But back to the question, how do you feel about more regulation and enforcement in the industry, and specifically in your area of the industry?
Thank you. You made a really important point where people romanticize this industry as something where you get to work as a trimmer, you get paid tons of money, which really isn't true anymore, that you get to work with pot all day, and really it's just manual labor. Like, it's just hard manual labor, and sometimes you get free weed, so that's cool. But how I feel about regulation, I have mixed feelings about it, like a lot of people. Obviously from a safety perspective, that's great, and awareness, but we've been used to working in the gray areas of the law and kind of like in the underground for so long that we're also concerned about our, like, people getting their sticky fingers on our communities that we've worked really hard to form under these conditions that we've been working in. And kind of even capitalizing on that, that's a fear. Another fear is that the price of a pound is just going to continue to drop. So every day when we're trimming at least one pound, it's going to be worth a lot less. So it's like we're putting in our blood, sweat, and tears into this, literally, because we're trying to like make that mark every day. It's like you get into competition really with yourself. You're like, I can just trim one more pound or whatever, and you're like, oh wait, but I really need to sleep in today because this is so hard. That pound is going to be worth less, meaning our physical grunt and labor is going to be worth less. And that makes it a lot less appealing of a profession because we want to get paid as much as possible. And so it's kind of like high risk, high reward when we're working in the underground. Like, we like got to be on defense, but we're also like making a lot of money.
By a union.
Preferably.
Labor union.
Yeah. I'm not in that industry, which is another reason why Annie felt safe asking me to speak, because it's not gonna, it's not a liability for me right now. I'm not gonna lose my job or like get followed to a farm or whatever. But I think that's a great idea. And I definitely think that some organization needs to happen to protect these women who are in the back country, basically, without a whole lot of protection against them. So, yeah, thank you.
I wanted to ask Amber a question about the edible business. So this is something that's come under fire in Oregon, where I live. They had to take all the edibles off the market. Oh my God, the rules were changing. They were too dangerous. And now everything has to be this tiny, tiny dose and so carefully regulated that it has taken the entrepreneurship out of it. And I was just wondering, how do you manage both a very careful dosage in products? And how do you manage the source material to check it for contaminants or pesticides?
So, testing.
Yeah.
It's all about the testing. I use concentrates because they're easier to, it's easier to figure out the dosage amounts and know the exact percentages and what you're working with and what you are infusing into your products. I use CO2 oils and things like that, but for eating purposes, I'm a big fan of ice water hash, so that's what I prefer to use. And I feel like it gives a very similar effect to eating things infused with flour, like almost like a whole plant type effect. But it's all about the testing. So, I have a steady source of ice water hash, and I get it tested as soon as I get the batch. And then I'll know at least what my starting material is and where I can start for my numbers, figuring out the dosage and the amount that needs to go into each batch. And then once that's created, then the product, the food product, then that gets tested just for consistency. So lots of testing, and it's expensive. So unfortunately, that's a part of it, but that's something that we've basically built into the cost.
There was a woman back there who had a question, and then a woman here has a question.
So make sure you have a knife or a taser.
Yes.
Do not accept beverages from anybody. Okay. Don't. Make sure you have sisters. 100%. Mm-hmm. A lot of these women are immigrants. They don't have paperwork, so they're scared shitless to go to the police. They aren't going to go to the police. I spent a lot of time handing out pamphlets to women's clinics to be able to go get tested, taken care of, abortion, whatever it may be. It's ugly sometimes. And it is absolutely real. Going forward, there's a happy ending to this. I then moved on. I was pretty good at the plant, so I started managing my houses in Oakland. I moved back to the city area. I also started running a farm outdoor and lighted up, which was awesome. I worked with really shitty guys. I got a gun pulled on me, and my dog almost got shot, and they were doing arms deals and cocaine deals on the property. At that point, I was like, I'm out. And I was at the threshold of how much do you want to do? I'm also from Washington, so.
Cool.
I am now a nursery owner, and while I was running farms, I hired all of them in teams. So there is definitely a lot of growers out there. I'm sure you worked on up north. There's a lot of cool boutique-y family-run farms.
Yeah, absolutely.
Take awesome care of their people. But there does, I'm stoked for legalization because that shit is just, it's not acceptable. Mm-hmm. Nothing terrible has ever happened to me. Debatable, but some of the women that I've worked with have gone through hell. And are catatonic at some point. You know, it's just, that's what they do. So, yeah. There's, I think, regulation is important. I actually had a question, though. Something that a lot of the girls that I worked with were really concerned about. Automation. So when it becomes regulated, there's going to be two things that happen. More automation, more trim machines, right? So that job is going to go. Two things are going to happen, the price, and as a grower also, the price per pound is constantly getting driven down. So as a grower, it's hard to keep paying the $250, that's what we would pay, $250, $200 a pound. It's really hard to keep that stable when your price per pound is, like in the last 4 years since I've been growing, it's gone from, you know, I could get $3,000 on some of our pretty pounds, and now we're down to like $1,300. Mm-hmm. So there's a big threat for the market there. And so it's interesting because a lot of these immigrants that do come in and work, they are getting, you know, well, at huge personal risk, as we already know. They're also financially standing to lose a lot with automation and legalization. So it's interesting because, like, there's this model that's shifting towards, okay, well, do we start doing it per pound? Or do we do $20 an hour or $10 an hour?
Right.
And it keeps going down. So what do you know, as far as your circuit goes, what are the ideas out there for trimmers to keep? Because I'm curious, I would love to keep paying people, and now I'm in nursery, so it's not as applicable, but it seems unfair to drive people out of business, out of their career, their livelihood, and they are on trim circuits. That is how they've made their money for the last 10 plus years. But at the same time, market costs is just driving it down to a place where it's not sustainable to pay that amount anymore. So I don't know if you've heard anything around that.
Yeah, the real answer to that question is I don't know, because there's so much really going on right now with trying to decide. There's a lot of moving parts in the trim industry. The time in which you can trim a pound really depends on the quality of the weed, and some of that weed, it's like heartbreaking to see it go into this trim machine where they just turn a dial and it's like shaved off at all the wrong spots. And yeah. It's like, what is this? Like, how are you going to sell this to a dispensary when it needs, like, bag appeal? It's...
I have a comment on that.
I was just going to say also, as trimmers, you know, you're gaining experience, right, that you can ultimately really apply to the more legal professional cannabis industry, right? And so there's definitely different things that you're learning about the plant, about the pesticides, about what it should look like, and you can really apply that. And you know, obviously I know that some of the trimmers, they do it because it's seasonal, they don't have to dedicate 40 hours a week. But you never know, you might be also finishing college and now you want to progress into something more legal. So, you know, take that into consideration too as trimmers, that you can definitely take that expertise and move that into the cannabis industry professionally. You can go into the processing department, you can go into sales because you know about the plants that you're selling. Half the time you probably trimmed, even though you don't know, you probably trimmed the plants that are there. So ultimately, you really can take that expertise. You don't have to stay in the shadows. And I know that was Harborside's motto, is out of the shadows into the light. We don't have to stay underground. You know, now that it's legal, we can really take that expertise and become entrepreneurs, move it into the cannabis industry so we're not behind. And I mean, and obviously as women in the cannabis industry, we still have to deal with some of those things, you know, that women have to deal with in any industry. But it's certainly more protected, you know, once you take that to the legal professional cannabis industry. So I would encourage trimmers who do have those concerns to try and just move that into the more legal, out of the shadows part of the cannabis industry.
Okay, thank you. I was gonna mention that, like, for myself, I would rather not trim anymore, but I would like a different kind of position in the more legal side of the cannabis industry. The problem is, who's gonna trim the weeds still? Like, who's gonna make it look pretty enough to sell? So it's like, we don't all have to stay in that position, but how do we pay those people that do stay in that position? It is an amazing industry for people that are immigrants and don't have means of getting paid in other ways, and can't interact with the public, really. Thank you.
Justin, make a quick comment. I know we're running over time. One more question. Look, the industry's got to change. Automation has got to be a part of it. We have to bring the cost of medicine down at the counter. The people who need the medicine can't afford it. We need to put our heads together to figure out how to bring the cost down. Automation plays a role in this. Of course, those finished buds at Magnolia, we have three kinds of buds. There's the C buds, the crappy little stuff that just falls off in those trim machines. The B buds, they're never gonna be perfect. The bakers need them, we're gonna make cash out of them. And the A buds, put those A buds through a trimmer and then send it to a trim crew that can fine tune it so that it's an A plus bud and it can go to my counter. Those other buds, put them through the automator, bring the price down and let's get the medicine out to people at a fair price. We have got to legalize it. This thing that you guys are describing to me, I'm horrified. Women being drugged through their beverages at the sites, are you kidding me? That's the number one, legalize it. We have to have this stuff come out of the darkness and into the light. The thing that you said about blood, sweat, and tears literally going into the medicine, I'm repulsed by that idea that the people in the trim rooms aren't using hair nets and beard nets and gloves and lab coats when they're handling our medical marijuana. That just cannot go on. You know what else? Let's make sure that we teach our sisters, our daughters, our friends to tell people to back the fuck up. Yeah. Back the fuck up. So let's use our voice and use it strong.
Thank you, Debbie. We've got one more question. And can I just move this around too? Like that way. Yeah. Thank you. All right.
Maybe one more.
Okay, one more. We're going to have one more question, then we're going to break for lunch over here.
Okay, I am a legal grower, one of the few, unfortunately, in Mendocino County. And the trimmers we have in the new regulations that are coming on, there's a lot of protection coming in, which is great, at least for Mendocino. You mentioned something about pesticides, and I grow CBD. I'm one of the few people, and we don't trim because the CBD is in the fan leaves and everything, so we just dry it and we bulk it up and it goes out to extraction and so forth. But the pesticide, I have neurological issues, so I'm shaking. It's not because I'm nervous. The pesticides that you're talking about, they're still being used right now. So everyone in here who smokes weed, if it's not tested really well, be very afraid, because some of these pesticides, like Eagle 20, if I got near it with my neurological problems, I would have a seizure. It's that bad. And you're smoking it or concentrating it down. Like my stuff gets concentrated with CO2 extract, or it's CO2 into a CO2 extract. And if you imagine all these pesticides then getting concentrated and then vaporizing it and inhaling it, it's the worst idea ever. And so for me, I'm looking forward to legalization, because then my biodynamic farm, and I'm a small farmer, and growing CBD is difficult. It's harder, you get less yield, the strains are not as strong, so you have to baby the plants, but it's worth it, because I know the patients my medicine goes to. I go through a dispensary, a local dispensary. It's a very small loop, and it's a great group. But the things that you're talking about, my neighbors all use trimmers, and I've heard good things and bad things, but it needs to go away. Which, if I did trim, I would use machines, because of that, of the abuses that I've heard, and it's as bad as you're talking about. And I'm there's a woman on my farm, and there's a woman on a lot of the farms that I know in my neighborhood. It's a very growing community. And when there's a mom there, when there's a woman there, or a wife, or whatever, it's quite different. I had some farm workers come up, and I cook for them. You know, we have family dinner. It's a different experience, but they're not sitting in one place. I've done trimming for my own self one time just to see what it was like. It took me literally, I think I got, it took me 15 hours to do 1 pound. And yes, I'm kind of spazzy with my hands because of my neurological stuff. So it took me longer than maybe if I didn't have it. But still, it's awful. Your shoulders, even when you're talking about it, your hands get, you know, you're using these little teeny scissors, trimmers, and you get spasms in your hands, you get blisters, your shoulders hurt, your butt hurts, your back hurts, and there's no way around it. So my question, sort of, to we have dispensaries here, so I'm really glad. I only worked with one dispensary, and I know them really well. But I've been trying to convince them, why do you have to have this hand trim look? Why can't you market it and educate people, the buyers? Look, it doesn't look the way it used to, because no one's a slave doing it. No one's getting hurt, no one's getting taken advantage of, and it looks this way. It's machine trimmed, it's cleaner. You know, the person that, you know, dealing with, and everyone who has touched this is wearing gloves. And most of the trimmers that I've heard of do not wear gloves. It's an unsanitary environment. You guys need to know this. It's disgusting. So anyway, for dispensaries, how do you educate people, or can you, that not everybody has to look perfect? That it doesn't have to have the hands for it.
Okay. As I said earlier, we're going to have a breakout session now, so you can ask your burning questions to these four incredible women over here, and we're going to reconvene in an hour. But one more thing, we have a quick announcement, and then we'll be back here in 1 hour. Go and support local businesses and get some lunch. Yes, ma'am.
It wasn't really an announcement. I just wanted to ask for the woman of color on the panel. I've worked and I've done a lot of work around white privilege and stuff, and I've noticed in the scene, and it's all white people mostly, except for maybe one person of color. And when I bring up the topics around this to them, you know, they're always pissed off, freaking out, hurt, whatever. And I'm just wondering if there's any articles or anything that's being written that you know of, even just small blogs or something, where I can actually be more informative to them and send them to those things.
I would reference the ACLU.
You can always subscribe to Oak Dex or Supernova or the Hood Incubators Facebook pages. I mean, our Facebook page is very active, and we're constantly posting things about what's going on really in the United States and in the world, and different ways that we can overcome exclusion and be more inclusive.
Yeah,